Hi, Jeff Nelson of VetSource. Thanks for tuning in. If you're not subscribed to my channel, please consider hitting subscribe now and scroll down into the description area below this video. You will see a link to sign up for my free email newsletter. I send one out about every couple of weeks. YouTube doesn't always show when a new video goes up, doesn't always show you, but if you're subscribed to my newsletter, you won't miss a thing. So make sure you go sign up. Okay, the topic for today's video was originally DHA. My last video debunked the need for DHA supplementation. Dr. Fuhrman wrote a rebuttal to my video on his website, and I was planning to analyze that rebuttal and explain where I thought he was incorrect. But that video is going to have to wait, because while studying the question, I discovered that one of the main studies used to promote the idea that vegans are deficient in DHA appears to have involved scientific misconduct. That got my attention. In fact, as you're going to hear, Professor Marion Nessel, who is the chair of nutrition department at NYU for many years, she's a best-selling author, she's a consumer advocate, she's exposed a lot of bogus corporate research. Professor Nessel said of this vegan DHA study, "No respectable journal should be publishing research like this." This is a DHA study funded by the Nutritional Research Foundation. Dr. Joel Fuhrman frequently references this study to sell his DHA supplement. While Dr. Fuhrman is the founder and president of the Nutritional Research Foundation, he has stated publicly that he had nothing to do with the study and he did not participate in it. In this video, I'm going to show you a variety of releases Dr. Fuhrman published on his website and private and public emails he sent while the study was being conducted, which show that not only did he participate in the study, but he was actually a principal investigator. When the study was wrapping up and just before the study was to be sent to journals to try and publish it, a decision appears to have been made to remove any mention of Dr. Fuhrman's involvement. Pages on Dr. Fuhrman's website were edited to remove his name from the list of researchers, and other pages where he had been listed were simply deleted from his website. This type of behavior is highly suspicious for research misconduct, has no place in science, and is the focus of today's video. Now, this video is an analysis of Dr. Fuhrman's involvement in this study, but it is not a statement about him personally or his qualities as a person. In fact, I want to say that I would like to thank Dr. Fuhrman. Dr. Fuhrman recently posted a video called Apology to Jeff Nelson and includes Dr. Esselstyn and Dr. McDougall. Dr. Fuhrman reached out to me a few weeks back by email. We had a nice exchange. I've made videos in the past several months on topics like nuts and vitamin D and DHA supplementation. Dr. Fuhrman made some personal comments about me, and for which he apologized, and I appreciate that. I accept that. It takes some guts in the YouTube world to publicly say that you regret something you said or did, and so I thank Dr. Fuhrman. I plan to continue examining nutritional science on this channel. If I discover something interesting, I will share it with my audience. Sometimes when working on one story on a particular topic, I unearth something interesting about another, and that's where I find myself today. This is the first of what will be a two-part series. I'm about to expose how I believe DHA supplements, and even the more recent focus on healthy fats, how this became a topic in recent years in the vegan community. Omega-3, DHA, healthy fats, these were never issues that were of concern to anybody or that they cared about when I went vegetarian 30 years ago or when I went vegan about 25 years ago. And this is not just because we were in the dinosaur age of the vegan diet, but it was because it wasn't important then and it isn't important now. Now, the one area where fish oil and DHA was once thought to be of possible benefit was in regards to heart health. But DHA supplements have been shown to be of no benefit to heart health. The American Heart Association says that anyone taking DHA supplements is doing so in the absence of scientific data that shows any benefit of the supplements. No other medical specialty other than cardiology has ever recommended DHA, including neurology, immunology, and psychiatry. So the DHA topic is recent in the vegan community, and just as in the past few years, it sort of started to come to a head, I've noticed. I've got a lot of videos on my channel. I started getting questions. Well, what about DHA? Why didn't you have videos on DHA or nuts? And the answer is because these aren't important topics, but it seemed to be becoming a critical issue on social media among people following a plant-based diet. So the issue of healthy fats has been wrapped in scaremongering as well, but not in good science. And that's why I decided to cover this issue. So people were asking me, how are we going to get enough good fats? And, you know, what about the catastrophic results that I've heard about for failure if you don't consume a DHA supplement? So Dr. Greger's name kept coming up, as in, you know, Dr. Greger saying this, Dr. Greger saying that. Dr. Greger seemed to be saying a lot of nonsense. So I had a look at what he was allegedly talking about. What I discovered is that Dr. Greger talks about the work of plant-based doctors who research and show a lot of great benefits of the vegan diet, and that is great. But then he complicates the vegan diet with a lot of hyperbole and touting a lot of weak corporate research, I believe, research which is, you know, very few of the plant-based doctors who are actually involved in researching and treating patients, very few of them believe this is relevant. And while I think Dr. Greger is a great guy with good intentions who's encouraged many people to go vegan, I don't consider him a particularly reliable source of nutritional information. So then I found out that Dr. Greger's source was Dr. Fuhrman when Dr. Fuhrman involved himself in the conversation. So what is the scientific misconduct that I've come across? It's this. Dr. Fuhrman set out to promote DHA. He devised and did a study about DHA, which was set up in a way to make vegans look deficient. When the study was done and they were sending it out to journals to try and get it published, a decision appears to have been made to remove Dr. Fuhrman from the study and to publish the study in a way that would hide the conflict of the fact that the study was run by someone who profits from the sale of DHA supplements. So why is this a problem? Well, as you're going to see, there are different terms for this. Ghostwriting is one, which is hiring someone to write up a study for your product. And ghost authoring is another, but both of these are considered in the professional scientific community to be unethical. Here's an example of ghost writing. Coca-Cola set up and funded research by independent outfits who did studies to show that lack of exercise and not sugary soft drinks were the root of obesity. It was bogus research that Coke had arranged for, paid for, and then they tried to present it as unbiased research when they were, you know, trying to protect their profits. Professor Marion Nessel is someone who busted Coke and exposed this scam. It was covered heavily in the national media, and she even wrote a book about it called Soda Politics. The result was Coke had to acknowledge and confess to what they had done. Everyone dismissed and ignored the research. Coke also agreed to make public, going forward, their involvement in any research surrounding soft drinks or obesity. Dr. Fuhrman has publicly and repeatedly denied he had anything to do with this DHA study. But in this video, I'm going to show you releases and statements Dr. Fuhrman himself put out that completely contradict his denials. You can be the judge. I'm going to be using archive.org a lot. This is a website that continuously makes copies of pages on the internet and stores them. And you can put in the URL of a page and from a website into the archive, and it will show you what that page looked like in the past at different times. So I'm putting links to anything that I'm going to cite here in the description so you can check all this yourself. So when did this concern about DHA appear in the vegan world? Well, looking back at Dr. Fuhrman's website, we can see that he was selling DHA around October of 2002. He was selling another company's DHA called Omega Zen. This is what his website looked like on October 17, 2002. When he first started selling Omega Zen DHA, you can see here his advertisement for the product. He noted that DHA deficiency can promote disease, aging, and even increase one's risk of cancer. I have found hundreds of patient complaints to be related to DHA insufficiency. Now, Dr. Fuhrman doesn't provide any links to studies or any evidence that DHA deficiency promotes aging or increases cancer risk, although he sounds very, you know, certain of himself here. This was in 2002, but we know today that the Vital study, for example, from Harvard, published earlier this year. It was 5 years of a randomized controlled trial, 25,000 people. It showed that DHA supplements did not lower cancer. In fact, it raised prostate cancer risk in men. Although Dr. Fuhrman said in the 2002 DHA supplement page that he had hundreds of patients who were sick due to DHA deficiency, he has never submitted a single case report to a medical journal documenting this or showing the evidence. At some point, Dr. Fuhrman made a decision to start selling his own brand of supplements. We see that by at least October of 2005, Dr. Fuhrman was selling his own DHA. See, it says October 30, 2005, and this is his brand, DHA Purity. In 2014, Dr. Fuhrman's research organization, the Nutritional Research Foundation, published a study which concluded that most vegans are deficient in omega-3, but that a DHA supplement, like the one Dr. Fuhrman sells, could correct that deficiency. This is the study. It's called Blood DHA and EPA in Vegans, Associations with Age and Gender and Effects of an Algal-Derived Omega-3 Fatty Acid Supplement. This is a study that Dr. Greger relies on in his video, arguing that vegans should take DHA supplement. In fact, he cites it a couple of times during the same video.
The problem is that people who don't eat fish may be under 4.4. Nearly two-thirds of vegans may fall below 4, suggesting a substantial number of vegans have an omega-3 status associated with accelerated brain aging. And here we go. They took those eating vegan with levels under 4, gave them algae-derived EPA and DHA, and about 250 milligrams a day, took them from an average of 3.1 over the line to 4.8 within 4 months.
Dr. Fuhrman himself also uses this study repeatedly in marketing his DHA supplements. He mentions it in articles, in lectures, and interviews.
And here's a research study on 166 vegans who were not supplementing with DHA, showing that 64 were insufficient levels of DHA for the brain.
A recent study was done following 166 vegans who were not supplementing with EPA and DHA. And interestingly, about 60% were insufficient and about 20% were deficient.
And here's a study we did on 166 vegans who were not supplementing with DHA, and we found that about a third of them were significantly deficient. Their omega-3 index was below 3.
It's important to know that omega-3 blood testing is not standardized. It's not like getting a cholesterol test or a test for thyroid function where labs agree on how to test. With omega-3 tests from separate labs, you can get very different results with the same blood sample. Not only that, but different companies have unique definitions for what constitutes optimal level, and some have their own special proprietary test that they claim is better than everyone else's. The point is, omega-3 testing is not standardized and experts have not established normal ranges. Doctors rarely test for omega-3 because few doctors see a need to test for it. It's experimental and it's not thought to be particularly relevant to anything. Low DHA levels have never been shown to cause any disease or health problem. DHA supplements are being studied primarily by people who make money from selling them or who profit from selling omega-3 blood tests. In determining who had sufficient omega-3 in their blood and who was deficient, Dr. Fuhrman's team decided that you have to have over 4% omega-3 in your blood or else you are deficient. Now, Quest Diagnostics, on the other hand, which is one of the biggest diagnostic testing outfits in the U.S., this is their page on omega-3. They say that being above 3.2% means you have an optimal level. That means that Dr. Fuhrman's team chose a considerably higher level for their study in order for someone to have optimal or desirable omega-3. OmegaQuant, another omega-3 testing lab, their owner was one of the authors of the Fuhrman DHA study. They define optimal as having 8% blood omega-3 and above. So it's all over the place. If Dr. Fuhrman's team had opted to choose the level that Quest Diagnostics and several other labs and hospitals, Cedars-Sinai, I know, if they had used their level of 3.2%, then most of the vegans in Dr. Fuhrman's study would have had optimal levels of omega-3 instead of most of them being deficient. The average blood level of patients in Dr. Fuhrman's study was 3.7%, according to the study. So the vast majority of those patients would be fine. There would be no need to have them take any DHA supplement. So by opting to use a higher definition in Dr. Fuhrman's study, two-thirds of the vegans, as well as two-thirds of non-vegans, were deemed to be deficient. So you can see when Dr. Fuhrman or Dr. Greger refer to this study as evidence that vegans are deficient, it's just because Dr. Fuhrman's team decided to pick a definition that made most people deficient. And everyone is deficient by Dr. Fuhrman's definition, whether you're vegan or not. It's equal. I'm going to be exploring this more in a future video, but the issue for this video is that it's problematic that The study's conclusion have a direct financial benefit to Dr. Fuhrman since he sells DHA. In fact, he sells the exact same DHA or the same type of DHA supplement that was used in the study. So that makes this study even more profitable for Dr. Fuhrman. Dr. Fuhrman has stated on multiple occasions that while his research organization funded the study, he personally did not participate in any manner. Here he is in three different interviews in the last couple of months where he says he wasn't involved in this study.
My literature and the research that is phonied, even though I wasn't even part of that research study. Oh, there was one research study done by the Nutritional Research Foundation that I was not a part of that study, one of the researchers on that project. It's not my own research. And I also helped fund the study, but I wasn't part of the study.
Now let's look at what Dr. Fuhrman said about his involvement before, during, and after the study. This is from the Nutritional Research Foundation website from November 2011, just as the study was getting started. This is Dr. Fuhrman's foundation he started and runs, and this is his website, and this release discusses the proposal for his DHA study. It says, the study will involve a national sample of over 200 male and female adults following a vegan diet for at least 3 years. And it explains why Dr. Fuhrman came up with this study. In his private practice, Joel Fuhrman, MD, has found that some of his elderly vegan male patients with Parkinson's disease have had very low levels of DHA in their blood despite intake of adequate ALA from nuts and seeds. Okay, so we know that the study is based on some anecdotes, patients who Dr. Fuhrman says he saw in his practice who had Parkinson's and low DHA levels. It goes on. The need for supplementation with non-animal sources of EPA and DHA is not widely known among those following the vegan diet. So, before the study begins, Dr. Fuhrman apparently believes there is an established need for DHA in the vegan community based on his personal observations. Dr. Fuhrman never submitted, as I say, a single case report to a medical journal describing any of these patients. No information is ever given on any other aspect of these patients' health and their histories, who he talks about, only that they had Parkinson's and low DHA levels. Dr. Fuhrman continues, an important first step in the effort to educate vegans about the need for supplementation is to document the level of these nutrients in the blood for a large sample of vegans over a wide age range. And you can see then at the bottom of this release, it says researchers conducting this project, Joel Fuhrman, MD, is the first one. Dr. Fuhrman explicitly states here that the purpose of his study is to, quote, educate vegans about the need for DHA supplementation. This point was so important that he put this part in bold in the release. Here is a newsletter sent out by Dr. Fuhrman in December of 2011. It starts, the Nutrition Research Project and Joel Fuhrman are teaming up with top researchers throughout the U.S. to show that chronic disease can be prevented and reversed with eat-to-live nutritarian lifestyle. And he mentions his DHA study. Our DHA study has received approval from the University of San Diego Institutional Review Board, and we will begin recruiting subjects soon. We are determining blood levels of omega-3 fatty acids, EPA and DHA, in vegans and examining associations with dietary intake. Perhaps you can help us get the word out. We need at least 250 subjects who have been vegan for at least 3 years and have not supplemented with DHA during the last 3 years. Dr. Fuhrman is reporting on the study in his email that he himself is doing here. He's saying, we're doing this, we need 250 subjects that have been vegan for 3 years. And as an aside, they weren't able to get 250 people who were vegan for 3 years. They ended up with 165 people who had been vegan for at least 1 year and weren't currently taking DHA supplements. So here is another page on the Nutritional Research Foundation's website. This is what it looked like in March of 2012. The study was already underway. Many participants had been tested. It lists Dr. Fuhrman as one of the two principal investigators of the study. It says the principal investigators are Barbara Sarter and Joel Fuhrman, MD, research director of the Nutritional Research Project. Dr. Fuhrman emailed me personally in March of 2012. He asked for my help recruiting vegans over 60. He said, we filled the below 60-year-old slots, but we have not found enough senior vegans yet to really answer the question if omega-3 conversion decreases with aging. So Dr. Fuhrman reached out to me because they needed more seniors. It was interesting to hear him give some of the study details. and that they needed more subjects over 60 because of how things were going. So, of course, I put out a newsletter. I said, Dr. Fuhrman needs you if you're over 60 and have been vegan for at least 3 years, would like to participate in his study. Dr. Fuhrman, along with the National Health Association, is studying omega-3 levels in the vegan population. The study is nearly full, but they still need men and women over age 60. And I gave links to web pages on Dr. Fuhrman's site where Dr. Fuhrman was listed as the principal investigator of the study. I wasn't the only one contacted. Dr. Fuhrman reached out to other vegetarian websites for help to get more seniors enrolled. Here is a screenshot from the Vegetarian Resource Group from April of 2012, trying to help them again. It lists Dr. Fuhrman as principal investigator. This is from the website of Jack Norris, a vegan dietitian from May of 2012. He was also told Dr. Fuhrman was heading the study. His page states Dr. Fuhrman is a principal investigator on the study. And again, it links to the same pages that I've already shown you that where Dr. Fuhrman is, you know, talking about the reasons for doing his study. Here is an update on the study from the Nutritional Research Foundation's website from October 2012. It says, this phase of the study is over, which I assume means the data collection phase, because blood tests were done during the first half of 2012. Here at the bottom, Dr. Fuhrman is still listed as principal investigator of the study. This is from the Nutritional Research Foundation's website from May of 2013. This is 18 months after the original proposal was put up on their website. Dr. Fuhrman is listed as principal investigator of the study. The completed study was received by the Journal for Publication in January of 2014, a little over 6 months later. When we look at the archive, we can see that between May of 2013, as the study was wrapping up to be sent to journals, and January of 2014, when it was accepted by a journal, during those 6 months, someone removed all of the various mentions of Dr. Fuhrman being involved in the study from his foundation website. So here, for example, on May 16th of 2013, Dr. Fuhrman is listed on his release as the first researcher in a list of three researchers. But by July 1st, 2013, 45 days later, his name has been removed from this page. A conscious decision was made to remove these pages that showed Dr. Fuhrman was involved in this study. Fuhrman's name was removed, or the page was deleted, and Dr. Fuhrman's name was not apparently included when the paper was submitted to journals. We know from his releases that Dr. Fuhrman was the person who came up with the idea for this study. He got the study approved at the University of San Diego along with Barbara Sarter. He launched the research foundation, and this is the DHA study was his flagship study. It was the first one he did. Dr. Fuhrman runs that foundation. He raises the donations. He hires the people to work there and write up the study. He signs the tax returns for the foundation. He emailed me and other people in the vegan community about his ongoing study to keep us abreast of what was going on, asking us for help with problems he was having. The purpose of the study, according to Fuhrman's own release, is to educate vegans about the need for DHA supplementation. It was not for the purpose of seeing whether DHA supplementation was necessary or seeing whether it produced some measurable health benefit for vegans. Dr. Fuhrman had a preconceived opinion that vegans simply needed to be educated, that they're deficient, and then they would want to start taking a DHA supplement. And Dr. Fuhrman and his team chose to define the optimal level of DHA, or rather of omega-3, in such a way that most people were deficient according to his definition. Now, contributing to a scientific paper and then not listing yourself as an author is known as ghost authorship, not to be confused with guest authorship. It's a form of scientific misconduct.
Here's an article published in a journal called Pain Management about ghost authorship. It's called
Ghost and Guest Authors, You Can't Always Trust Who You Read. It says, because of their important role in guiding medical practice, the authorship of articles must be honest, reliable, trustworthy, and transparent. Otherwise, the reader cannot adequately appraise the paper. And it talks about how the public and medical professionals can be misled when people don't disclose their involvement. Ghost and guest authorships are unprofessional and unethical. However, the most important and underlying issue is that ghost and guest authors have the potential to unjustly manipulate patient care through their influence on physicians and educators who read these articles. Such authorships deprive the reader of the chance to satisfactorily weigh a published paper. It's unusual for someone who is so heavily involved, you know, the key person in a study, to have their name removed. Here's another article, and this one is published in a journal called Accountability in Research. Haunted Manuscripts, Ghost Authorship in the Medical Literature. Ghost authorship is ethically questionable in that it may be used to mask conflicts of interest with industry. So if you're Coca-Cola, when you mask the fact that you're behind a study that's to your financial benefit, it's called ghost authorship. It's still called ghost authorship when a plant-based doctor does the exact same thing. In the UK, ghost authorship is considered misconduct. It's included under the category of misrepresentation.
This is a statement on misconduct in research from the University of Leicester, a public research university ranked as one of the top 200 universities in the world. Under examples of misrepresentation, they include denial of authorship where the author has made a significant contribution.
Again, Coca-Cola's phony self-serving marketing research was exposed by Professor Marion Nestle. Professor Nestle has written many books about how the food and supplement industries use biased science to make marketing claims to try and get people to buy their products. Her latest book, Unsavory Truth, is terrific. I have a one-hour video with her on my channel, which is a must-watch video. Here's a quote from Professor Nestle's book. When should you be skeptical? Anytime you see a report that a single food, beverage, supplement, food product, or ingredient causes or reduces the risk for obesity, heart disease, type 2 diabetes, or cancer, it's a good idea to envision a red warning flag flying high in the air. Now, I told Professor Nestle about this study of Dr. Fuhrman's. Here was her comment. This case is exactly why the issue of conflicted interest concerns me and why I wrote Unsavory Truth in the hope of bringing these kinds of actions to public attention. Ghostwriting is when someone with a vested interest pays someone else to write up research results. At best, this is someone who deeply believes that vegans need supplemental omega-3s and is trying to make it easy for them to get those nutrients. At worst, this is someone who, out of motives that we cannot know, has invented a non-existent problem and is selling an expensive product to solve the problem. I see several issues here that ought to trouble anyone looking at this situation. The invented problem, the manipulation of research to give a desired result, the non-disclosure of vested interest, and the ghostwriting, all of which violate principles and standards of research ethics. No respectable journal should be publishing research like this. Dr. Fuhrman has stated publicly on multiple occasions that he did not participate in this study. The evidence suggests that not only was he involved, but that he was the principal investigator for the entire duration of the study, and like Coca-Cola, the moving force behind the research, according to his own website and public releases. The preamble to the American Medical Association Code of Medical Ethics says, a physician shall uphold the standards of professionalism, be honest in all professional interactions, and strive to report physicians deficient in character or competence or engaging in fraud or deception to appropriate entities. The legal definition of fraud is the intentional use of deceit, a trick or some dishonest means to deprive another of his, her, its money, property, or a legal right. I want to encourage people again to watch my one-hour interview with Professor Marion Nestle. This issue of the quality of science, of undisclosed conflicts and commercial science being used to dupe people, it's important work. Commercial science is not real science, and Professor Nestle explains the many reasons why. Most people following a plant-based lifestyle are aware that the meat and dairy industries use sketchy scientific studies to bolster their bottom line. And so do some food companies and supplement sellers that are plant-based. I want to add that I'm in no way opposed to people selling products to the vegan community. In fact, I'm in favor of it and I support it. But I'm opposed to scaremongering and I'm opposed to distorting information. On a personal note, I try to rely on doctors and experts who don't have competing agendas. Your health is too important to trust to speculation or marketing tactics. And that's it for today. Thank you for watching all the way to the end. There'll be a part two soon. Please share this video with others if you like it. Give it a like, and don't forget to sign up for my free newsletter. Okay, thanks.